case you didn't know, that was Scotland the Brave, which is kind of a grand tune. I call upon the chaplain to offer the invocation.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, on this day you bestowed upon peoples of every race and nation the light of your Holy Spirit. We give you thanks and offer our prayers for the St. James School class of 2022, who individually and collectively represent the wonderful diversity of the world you have made. We ask you, dear Lord, to bless these graduates and fill them with your Holy Spirit. As they go forth from this Fountain Rock land, may they always remember the work, challenges, and triumphs that got them to where they are, and the lessons from them that helped them grow. May they also remember those who have cared and loved them along the way. As they go forth into the world by the power of your Holy Spirit, we pray, O God, for that very spirit to burn brightly within this graduating class. We pray that through that spirit they will set the world ablaze, making positive differences wherever in this world you take them. May these graduates always have a spirit of discernment and continual want to learn and share the goodness of knowledge with others. And may we and all others see through their continual seeking after truth and knowledge and generous acts of giving, you as the source of all wisdom, truth, and true happiness. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. I would like to begin by noting what I'm sure all of you are thinking, and that this is our first proper and traditional commencement in 3 years. And that is in itself a great blessing and very appropriate for this class who have traveled this COVID journey with us. 19 of this class came as second formers, so they are graduating after 5 years. Last year on campus, we started the year, we should say not this past year, but the year before, with everybody vaccinated and present and an active learning community, initially of about 140 that grew to about 180 with some remaining virtual. And that was an extraordinary experience because we functioned, as I know many parents will remember, very much as a bubble. And that created a kind of intensity and kind of unity of community that we have never experienced, and at least in my time. And it was remarkable. And this form, I really want to make this point, was here in numbers, actually more than the sixth form at the time. And I know that that was very bonding for all of you, with each other, with your teachers, and with those many younger formers who look up to you. This form, in many ways, is a gift to us. We've had an outstanding group of prefects and sacristans, but the whole form has led well and has really helped us to reestablish and rebuild our culture as St. James, which was a real concern to us. This form is especially strong in music and drama and the arts, which is well-timed with the new Pohanka Center for the Fine Arts, and with very strong students and very strong athletes as well. They are finishing well, with each and all of them at a place of gratitude and appreciation. And it is, frankly, an achievement in itself to finish this journey, as St. James is increasingly different than the other places where you can go to school, and in that way, or in those ways, a more challenging experience. Our unique combination of smaller size, boarding, diversity, tradition, and achievement really creates a very powerful experience here, which is often very challenging. But we have, and I spoke to this in chapel before, the anchoring and gathering role of the chapel, which makes sure that we don't worship ourselves or worship the school or worship achievement, but worship God. Probably most importantly, students at St. James and all of you completing this journey, you haven't been able to cherry pick here. I'll do this because it makes me feel good or look good. Nope, you do it all. You're challenged to play that additional sport, to discover an artistic or musical talent, to take at least 5 academic subjects every year, and to live the common life of the school with chapel and seated meals. It means you wake up in the morning. And you don't, attend your classes in your pajamas on the other side of a screen. You're forced to be polite, respectful, and honest. And you live as part of a community which does not in any way revolve around you. And this is a difference for you which your parents have chosen. And this has been wise on their part. Where you are playing for the team and not just for yourself, where you are leading by serving, where you are singing and serving to enhance the worship of God and not the worship of you. I think one of the best things about chapel is we don't applaud when the choir sings an anthem, which they do very well. So congratulations and well done. And the best way to say goodbye, as I always tell the school, is to say thank you. Thank you to our supporters and donors whose giving purchased our land, built our buildings, and established our endowments, which together with the annual fund pays 1/4 of our operating budget, so that every student here, every single one, is essentially receiving substantial financial aid. We should be grateful to our maintenance, housekeeping, and dining staff who have worked through very hard conditions to maintain this incredible campus and to give us this beautiful setting. Our administrators and office staff, our teachers and our coaches who have, and it's not overstating this, very much loved you. And again, COVID has brought many additional tasks and duties that we, spraying down the classrooms every morning and gathering, with masks on and separately and all everything that we've had to do, everything you've had to do, just know that the adults who take care of you have had to do more of it. In many ways, our motto says it all. Every good gift and every perfect act of giving is from above. Because this reminds us to be grateful and mindful of our many gifts and blessings. But perhaps more importantly, it challenges us, and now this class especially, with the very purpose of life, to join in the giving purposes of God, to live lives of meaning and purpose, to feel His power working through us, to perform His miracles, to be His gifts to the world. So this is our prayer for you, and your journey here, I hope, has prepared you. Amen. It is customary to award scholastic prizes in recognition of achievement in the various subjects as evidenced by highest grades. These were awarded on prize day as follows. The following middle school students received prizes on prize day, Saturday, June 4th. The middle school headmaster's prize was awarded to Kaylin Kathy Zhang, Beijing, China. The Rich Memorial Prize for the highest GPA in the middle school and the prize for excellence in history were awarded to Yixi Sisi Yao, Beijing, China. The prize for excellence in English was awarded to Claire River Barnes, Greencastle, Pennsylvania. The prize for excellence in Latin was awarded to Stephen Hidong Kim, Seoul, South Korea. The Reichert Middle School Science Prize was awarded to Kendall McKenzie Brown of Martinsburg, West Virginia. The prize for excellence in mathematics was awarded to Yiwen Joey Shu, Hangzhou, China. The prize for excellence in religion was awarded to Noah James Kotz, Martinsburg, West Virginia. The prizes for all-around athletic ability were awarded to Claire River Barnes of Greencastle, Pennsylvania, and Seth James Alavedo, Boonesboro, Maryland. The Marianne Hatcher Memorial Prize for love of learning and genuine care for other students, given by her father George Hatcher, class of 74, was awarded to Murray Lillian Brawner, Hagerstown, Maryland. The following fourth form students received prizes on Prize Day. The Waller Wynn Prize for Non-Western History and Culture was awarded to Andrew Shue Sullivan, Tucson, Arizona. Excuse me. The Clarence W. Wheelwright Prize for Devotion to Duty, endowed by Dr. and Mrs. Gallier of Baltimore, was awarded to Minjie Daniel Liu, Hangzhou, China. The Tim Shryock Prize for Willingness to Serve, endowed by Tim's mother, Mrs. Shryock, was awarded to Parker Haley Risser, Hagerstown, Maryland. Thank you. Don't worry, I have terrible allergies. The following fifth and sixth form students receive prizes. The Prize for Excellence in English, endowed by Mr. Richard Turner, given in memory of Russell and Wilhelmina Nelson, was awarded to Audrey Alexandra Johnson of Frederick, Maryland. The Prize for Excellence in Latin was awarded to Xiaotao Teresa Sheng, Liaoning, China. The Prize for Excellence in Spanish, given in honor of George C. Belden, longtime master of St. James School by the class of 1959, and the Prize for Excellence in Mathematics were awarded to Royan Yanni Gao, Bethesda, Maryland. The Henry Kidd Douglas Prize for English Composition, the Prize for Excellence in Biology, and the Prize for Excellence in European History were awarded to Yuxing Lin Chen, Madrid, Spain. The Farah Science Prize for Outstanding Achievement in Science was awarded to Camilla Maria Power of Edmonds, Washington State. The Bowman Byron Fine Arts Prize was awarded to Holly Elizabeth Gaver Butcher, Frederick, Maryland. The United States History Prize, endowed by Mr. Sims A. Jamison, longtime friend of St. James School, was awarded to Andrew George Weisgerber, Frederick, Maryland. The Prize for Excellence in French was awarded to Danse Nuanchit Yanu, Laurel, Maryland. The Prize for Excellence in Chemistry, in memory of Dr. Marion Vizi, endowed by Mrs. Vizi, was awarded to Chenhao Harry Wei, Shanghai, China. The Prize for Excellence in Art, endowed by Mrs. Elizabeth R. McLeod, was awarded to Ryan Michael Scott of Hagerstown, Maryland. The Prize for Excellence in Music, endowed by Mr. Robert W. Grab, in memory of his father, Charles L. Grab Sr., and his mother, Elizabeth P. Grab, was awarded to Yilin Peter Yang, Shanghai, China. The John C. Campbell Memorial Prize for the Most Improvement in Oral Communication while at St. James was awarded in the fifth form to Andrew George Weisgerber, Frederick, Maryland. And in the sixth form, to also Mede Beatrice Imariagbe, Williamsport, Maryland. The St. Lawrence Book Award is awarded in recognition of the value that the St. Lawrence community places on service to others, honoring the achievements of a high school junior who has displayed a significant commitment to community service. This year, the award was presented to Xiaotao Teresa Sheng, Liaoning, China. The Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute Award was given to a fifth former who is an outstanding math and science student who demonstrates potential for success in the science or technology-related profession, who demonstrates consistent achievement and testing performance, and who adheres to rigorous academic standards. It was awarded to Royan Yanni Gao, Bethesda, Maryland. The State of Maryland Merit Scholastic Award certificates were given to Camilla Maria Power, Edmonds, Washington, Huxi Jesse Wang, Tianjin, China. On Wednesday, May 18th, certificates of membership in the St. James chapter of the Cum Laude Society were given in the fifth form to to Lily Claire Kukuzela, Royon Yanni Gao, Xiaotao Teresa Sheng, Chanyao Harry Wei, and Andrew George Weisgerber. And in the sixth form, to Cauley Wannell Ferguson, Ryan Michael Scott, Chiao-Chu Dwayne Watkins, and Emily Shang, Yuxing Lin Chen, Dokyong Oh, Camilla Power, Hushi Jesse Wang, and Jihan Ani Zhao were elected members in their fifth form year. I now introduce our commencement speaker, and we're very honored to have our congressman, the Honorable David Trone, with us. And as you may know, we just finished our 180th year. So it's a significant year in the history of the school. Congressman Trone was elected to the House of Representatives in November of 2018 to serve the 6th District of Maryland, which includes all or part of Montgomery, Frederick, Washington, Allegheny, and Garrett counties. Congressman Trone serves on the Appropriations, Veterans Affairs, and Joint Economic Committees. In Congress, he is particularly engaged in the mental health and addiction crises, criminal justice reform, and funding for medical research. To help combat the opioid and mental health crises, Congressman Trone founded and serves as the co-chair of the Bipartisan Addiction and Mental Health Task Force, alongside Democrat Annie Kuster and Republican Brian Fitzpatrick and Jaime Herrera Butler. Most recently, he served as co-chair of the Commission on Combating Synthetic Opioid Trafficking with Republican Senator Tom Cotton. Before coming to Congress, Congressman Trone founded and ran a successful business, which today employs over 12,000 team members in over 230 stores in over 27 states across the country. Congressman Trone, welcome and thank you for joining us. Good to have you. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm certainly glad I did not have to pronounce some of those names. I absolutely would have butchered it. But you did a great job on that. So thank you for inviting us here today. And first and foremost, congratulations to the class of 2022. I'd also like to applaud the other folks that helped you get here today, your parents, and how about the teachers, the professors, the staff here at St. James? As a father of four, I know full well that it takes a team to get your kids through elementary, middle, and then finally high school. It's clearly a full-time job, and you've all brought it home today. So it's an exciting moment, and we couldn't have a more beautiful day than we have today on this campus with this magnificent tree in front of me, just blown away. Unbelievable. So it's an honor to celebrate with you here today, but being just a few years older than you, maybe quite a few. I can remember back what it was like when I graduated high school. My school had 80 students in a graduating class. And how many do we have here? 49. So my school is a big school compared to this. It was all folks from a farming community, a small town of East Berlin, Pennsylvania, in Adams County, near, not too far from here, really, near Gettysburg is where it is. Our school was a public school. It was ranked 399th out of 402 in Pennsylvania. I think that point is pretty clear when you think about that. And then I think about what we have here at St. James is truly incomprehensible. You are so blessed to have this unbelievable campus, fields, beauty, 1,000 acres, and the teachers, the professors of this quality, and the staff and the leadership that you have here, you truly have an unbelievable advantage. And as was said a little while ago in chapel, and I wanted to reiterate that, the line from the movie Saving Private Ryan, you've now got to earn it. And I know you will, because you're starting off many steps ahead of certainly where I started and probably everybody in this audience started. You've really been given some wonderful advantages, and your parents stepped up and made it happen. When I went to school, I was nervous, graduated nervous but excited. The adventure you're about to embark on, you're going to face adversity. You're going to feel challenged. And you'll often feel discouraged. You often may want to hold up the white flag and just take the easier path out. But of course, the answer is never. Never do that. You need to continue the fight. Now more than ever, we need courageous leaders. We need innovative change agents in our country and in the world. My background is growing up on a 200-acre chicken and hog farm in Adams County. We farmed corn and wheat and hay, and I lived the farm life till I was 28, when bankruptcy claimed the farm. But from that, and what you're taking from St. James, the same thing, is a work ethic. A work ethic to be there and focus to get the job done and be willing to go at all times the extra mile when it's called for. After that, I founded a small business in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And it was a corner store selling beer and wine. And in that store, because we had no dollars, no money, my brothers, I'm the oldest, and my mom, who I was supporting at the time after the bankruptcy, we built the cash register stands. We built the beer cooler. We didn't have dollars to put a sign on the wall. It was neon. So we painted a big black square and wrote the name in yellow in the middle of it and sold beer and soft drinks to support ourselves. That store, that one small store, because we have been so fortunate and had that work ethic that came from growing up and being raised and the background like you have here at St. James, we've been able to grow that. This year we'll finish over 250 stores across the United States with $5.5 billion in sales. And the key on that is outworking everybody. And that work ethic, at the end of the day, if you put in the time, you put in the effort, you will do very well. But you must put in the time. That ability to build a successful business gave us the ability to run for Congress. Congress is an extension of our philanthropy. We've worked through our foundation with education and medical research and criminal justice and probably 20,000 other causes that we've donated over $100 million to. But I can't move the needle in a big way. Only government can do that. So we'd love to see you folks involved in government, whether it's here, China, Korea. We need folks that are change agents across the world that are striving to make things just better for everybody. But by being in Congress and focusing on the things that we care about, addiction, mental health, the mental health crisis we have in America now, medical research, with an 8-to-1 ROI. We have an opportunity to move literally billions of dollars to things that really matter to all of us. And that's an honor to be able to do that. But in my decades of business and public service, we've taken away some good ideas and we've had some bad ones. But through those trials and tribulations, came up with a handful of principles, not only to succeed in life, but how we leave the world in a little better spot than when we found it when we first got here. I'd like to pass on a few of those good ideas as you begin your journey. Number one is, you have a boss now, don't you? You probably have a lot of bosses, don't you? Your mom, your dad, your teachers, maybe you have a job, you have a boss there at work. They tell you what to do, they tell you where to go, they tell you when to be there, they told you today where to sit, they told you today where to march. But as of today, you're going to have, when you venture out, a new boss. Who is that new boss, do you think? You got it. Absolutely. First row, she nailed that one. You're your new boss. That's a pretty big change. It's a pretty scary change in a lot of ways. Think about it. All these great leaders and folks that really care and are nurturing and driving and supporting you, and all of a sudden you're out there in college on your own, and you're the boss. You get to decide when you're going to study, how much you're going to study, when you're going to goof off, how much you're going to goof off. That's a pretty big change. It's the most impactful change, an important change that's going to happen after you leave St. James. So the first takeaway, the takeaway number one is, you're the new boss. And your decisions, they're your decisions now, are going to be very, very important of where you land and the life you create in the next 10, 20, 30, 40 years. Number two, the new boss, you, has choices. You have opportunities to think what I call ST and LT. What do you think ST stands for? Short term, right? What do you think LT? We know that one, right? Long term. So you've got all these choices to think when you do your decision making, short term versus long term. Do I study or do I not? How long do I study? Do I start at midnight or do I start in the afternoon? Do I start the week before or do I start the night before? You've got choices about when you go out with your friends and take that downtime, which is very important. But you have to make choices about how that's going to work, because all these choices are going to have consequences. And that's going to be very important long term. When I went to college, I went to undergraduate at Furman University in South Carolina, where I've been a trustee for almost 15 years now. I always tried to think long term. And did I have fun? Absolutely. The best 4 years of my life. Phenomenal. But going to class, that was a choice. And I would say, make the choice to go to every single class. You'll never spend a better hour and get a better return on your investment, your time, than going to every class. And we had choices about studying and choices then about what grades we got in those various courses. Came out of the choice we made, short or long term. At Furman, I chose to work hard, but still have a great event, great time. And I graduated magna cum laude, Phi Beta Kappa. And that expanded long-term options, LT options. Because the little decisions you make short-term lead to opportunities or a lack of opportunities long term? Can you get into that graduate school, the top one you want to be at? Can you get into that doctorate program? Can you get that job with the consulting company or investment bank that you might want? The tough jobs. So every day as you go through, you have these myriad of decisions, short term, seemingly inconsequential. But at the end of the day, they're very consequential because they form the basis of long-term choices that you'll have. Takeaway number two is long-term thinking expands your choices, or short-term thinking limits your choices. Number three is hold on to your important relationships. As was just said in chapel, this is the last day you'll probably ever be together as a group. I've attended all my reunions, high school, undergraduate, graduate school, and every year there's less and less. But today's that day where these relationships are here at their peak. And relationships, your friends, your teachers, those connections, they're the ones who are going to give you the honest advice. And it's hard in life to get honest advice, especially the further are you up the food chain. The more they want to tell you what you want to hear, not what you need to hear. Also, these friends will add your enjoyment and quality of life forever. I've kept two of my friends from kindergarten, and that's hard work maintaining friendships for that many years. And friends from high school, friends from college. And it takes work. So you've got to put the work into your relationships. You've got to pick up the phone and call folks. Send them a text. Send them emails. Make a point to stop by and see them. But once you begin to lose contact, it's really hard to reestablish it. But these are the folks that you shared so much. You've went through tough times and easy times, great times. But hold on to those relationships. So point number three, takeaway number three is keep the relationships. They'll tell you the truth, and they'll give you great happiness. Number four is failure. I love failure. Failure is really, really good. Because with failure, we build success. Who in this audience has failed? Like, hello, everybody? I should raise both hands, because we've all had so much failure. At my company, we actually, in our annual reviews, grade people on failure. If they haven't had failure, they're not going to hit the ceiling. They're not going to reach for all they could be. They're going to just settle for mediocrity. You've got to push the limits. And sometimes when you push, you will not succeed and you'll fail. But it doesn't matter. You'll learn. You'll get up. You'll build resiliency. And you'll keep moving. After college, when I went back to work on that farm, I was there until I was 28. My father had a substance use disorder. He was an alcoholic. He made terrible decisions. And we went bankrupt. That failure. They took the farm, the banks did. They took our home. My parents divorced. But that failure led to the next step in life, and that was to go to graduate school. And in graduate school, at the Wharton School of Business, where I got my MBA, I had another business I started then, brokering eggs. I was a telephone guy before there were cell phones. I lived on a pay phone in Vance Hall, and between classes called brokers to sell eggs from Pennsylvania to New York, from New York to Mississippi and back and forth, and made 2 cents, a couple cents a dozen. And that's how we supported ourselves, myself, my mother, and the younger kids, after the farm went under. But about a year and a half into that, the avian flu hit the industry, and millions of chickens were destroyed. including all the ones I brokered the eggs for. So again, you have failure. You're out of business. You don't have what you thought you were going to have. But from that, you take that resiliency, that toughness. That led to starting the company now, Total Wine and More, which, as we spoke about, is the largest retailer of wine and spirits in the United States. But if it wasn't for that failure and repeated failure, we never would have been able to build a company across the country and never been able to afford to go into public service and have the resources to do it the right way. Takeaway number four is we learn from failure. It's a great thing. Don't quit. Don't let it get you down. Number five is live your life with compassion. Compassion for others that are less fortunate. Vice President Hubert Humphrey is well before your time, but some of your parents remember him under Lyndon Johnson, said, "The test of government is how we treat those in the shadows of life, the elderly, the sick, the needy." If we make those type of decisions, a focus and help with compassion and caring, we'll all be better for it because we're all in this thing together. In Congress, I work on addiction. We lost 107,000 Americans last year to overdose deaths. Is that number pretty unbelievable? We've now lost over 1 million Americans since 1999 to overdose deaths, starting with Oxycontin to heroin, and now it's fentanyl. Over 70% of those deaths last year were fentanyl. I lost a nephew. He was 24. Lovely young man. Died alone in a hotel room of fentanyl overdose. He didn't want to take fentanyl. It wasn't his plan. But at the end of the day, fentanyl, and you need to be aware of this, is not something that's only in heroin or cocaine or even maybe sprayed on marijuana. Fentanyl is now mixed in Percocet, Xanax, Adderall, all the regular drugs that you might think were okay to pop at a party for someone that has no addiction, zero addiction, just picked up a Percocet or a Xanax at a party. Those are now being made by the two leading Mexican cartels. They're mixing in fentanyl because it addicts the people. But they're not good mixers. They put too much in periodically. And we have 107,000 dead. Stanford estimates we'll lose 1.2 million people in the next 10 years. It's a national epidemic. In Congress, I also work in a bipartisan way on mental health. We have a mental health crisis in America with depression, anxiety. Coming out of COVID, we've all seen the challenges that we faced. But in Congress, we can get things done and move literally billions of dollars. And President Biden is putting over $5 billion more this year into addiction and into mental health. So he's putting money where his values are. Takeaway number five is be compassionate. Think about others. That's who America is. That's who we are as a country. We think about other people, not just ourselves. That's what makes us the country we are. Number six is practice civility. In business and in life, we can get stuff done if we worked respectfully with everyone. In Congress, everything I do is bipartisan. Every bill is bipartisan. Republicans, Democrats, working together as a team. That's how we can stop addiction, the mental health crisis, support our police, invest long-term in medical research and education. So takeaway number six is civility and teamwork. That's how you get stuff done. Treat everyone with respect. Number seven is build your competence. What does that mean, build your competence? The best lessons I learned were not from a book or necessarily a lecture, but they came from experience, the experience of doing something, maybe not doing it well, but actually getting involved in the nuts and bolts. When you jump in with both feet and get involved, you'll learn. Even better is listening. It's a lost art. Everyone's so busy talking, and we're so busy reading our phones that we forget to listen. And if we listen, and we listen thoughtfully, we can learn so much. And how about reading? I love to read. Books, magazines, newspapers, all the time, relentlessly. Because when we read, we can learn again from others. So it's a lifelong journey of education. And you've got to focus on listening, reading. The takeaway is if we do that, we're going to move forward. And we're going to learn to embrace change. Because the way you're going to succeed is become a change agent. And live comfortably with change. Because the world's moving faster and faster. And as it continues the speed, it's going to do a 180 over and over. So you've got to get comfortable with change. But too often our leaders aren't good with change. They want the status quo. We may not understand it fully, but we've got to jump in with both feet and learn about it. So change is how we can drive a better country, better education system, and propel you forward and build your competence. So takeaway number 7 is if you build your competence, you can do anything. So at the end of the day, you're the new boss. Decisions are important. Number 2, long-term thinking that expands your choices. 3, builds relationships for honesty and happiness. Number 4, failure is really good. Learn it and move on. Number 5, be compassionate. It's who we are. And number 6, civility. Teamwork gets stuff done. And number 7, build your competence and you can do anything. So yes, the rest of your life starts today. It's there for the taking. Not only are you responsible for those day-to-day decisions, but you now, you hold the potential for what you're going to be doing in 5, 10, 20, 40 years. That outcomes are all about the incomes, what you put into it today and tomorrow and each day. Don't let the chance to define your future pass you by. Take care of today, but never neglect tomorrow. As I look across the graduates, I'm proud to represent what a promising generation. And I love the diversity of this class. That gives you another huge advantage. All that diversity gives you different ways of thinking that you're exposed to. If we all looked alike, we'd all get the same answers. So the diversity that we have in this class that the administration has assembled here today is so crucial for your future success and will give you that foundation of being comfortable with any and everyone and hearing ideas that are quite different and experiences that are quite different than your own. So don't let opportunity slip through your fingers. Take it by the horns. You all have a bright future. Let's earn it. Take pride in what you've accomplished so far. And have a wonderful summer, and thank you very much.
He's coming again, I'm just saying. That was really terrific. Non-scholastic prizes are awarded to members of the student body who during their years at St. James made noteworthy contributions to the life of the school, or who have exhibited outstanding qualities of leadership and such characteristics as integrity, cooperation, loyalty, and seriousness of purpose. Most prizes are awarded on the basis of a 2/3 vote by the faculty. The Onderdonk Headmaster's Prize, endowed by Mr. and Mrs. Richardson Onderdonk, class of 1935, in memory of Henry Onderdonk, headmaster of St. James School from 1869 to 1895, and Adrian Onderdonk, headmaster from 1903 to 1939, is awarded to that member of the sixth form who has served others beyond the St. James community, way beyond what is required of a St. James student. It is awarded this year to Asa Paniotis Hammer, Shepherdstown, West Virginia. If Father Montgomery will come forward to give the chaplain's prize. Awarded by the chaplain to that member of the sixth form who best exemplifies the primal purpose of St. James School in training young people for lives of Christian witness and devotion, as shown by faithful attention to church life, courteous consideration of other people, and a high sense of personal integrity, is awarded this year to Sungbum Lee, Sonnam-si, South Korea. The Sims A. Jamison Prize, endowed by Mr. Jamison to the sixth former who has shown the most improvement while at St. James, is awarded to Thomas Anthony Starkowski III, Frederick, Maryland. The A. Smith Bowman Prize to that sixth former whose consistently polite, kind, and gracious behavior sets the standard for his peers and benefits the society of the school, is awarded this year to Kali Wanell Ferguson, Frederick, Maryland. The Margaret Aiken Pennington Prize, given by Mr. and Mrs. William Pennington, Jr., class of 1970, in memory of Margaret Pennington, longtime librarian and advisor to the first class of girls at St. James, to that sixth former whose consistently polite, kind, and gracious behavior sets the standard for her peers and enhances the society of the school. It is awarded this year to Paris Alexa Thiele, Greencastle, Pennsylvania. The Charles G. Meehan Jr. Class of 65 Athletic Ability Prizes are awarded to a male and a female athlete in the sixth form who have shown extraordinary ability in at least two sports. They are awarded this year to Jensen Mahoney, Keedysville, Maryland, and Sean James Rowe, Fairplay, Maryland. The David I. Barr Prize is awarded to that athlete in the sixth form who has shown outstanding sportsmanship and leadership in at least two sports. It is awarded this year to Daniel Paul Peacher, Hagerstown, Maryland. The Don Porter Prize, given in memory of Don Porter, class of 1949, is awarded to that member of the sixth form who has shown genuine courage and real devotion to the team above and beyond the call of duty in at least two sports. It is awarded this year to Collie Wannell Ferguson, Frederick, Maryland. The Class of 1950 Award for Creativity, supported by the Class of 1950 Fund, is given to that member of the sixth form who has been creative and original through its significant achievement or work which enlivens the spirit of the school. This achievement or work can be in any field, academic, artistic, dramatic, musical, or athletic. It is awarded this year for her achievement in academics beyond the school to Camilla Maria Power, Edmonds, Washington. Just so you know, she's been researching at Caltech while she's been with us, and she goes to Caltech next year. The Noble C. Powell Prize is awarded to that sixth former who, by the creative exercise of imagination and initiative, has made an outstanding contribution to change, development, and progress at St. James School while remaining faithful to its fundamental principles and purposes, and is awarded this year to Ryan Michael Scott, Hagerstown, Maryland. For those of you who don't know him, Ryan is an incredible artist, and he has been for some time, and he's incredibly generous in offering his art to improve the school in many aspects of our life, and in ways that really no one has ever done at his scale before. So well done. The school prize is given on occasion by the headmaster to a member of the sixth form who, in his opinion, has shown faithful devotion to St. James School. It is awarded this year to Sungbum Lee. The Mary Latrobe Onderdonk Memorial Prize for Sound School Citizenship is awarded to Charlton Dwayne Watkins, Frederick, Maryland. Kim, if you'll come forward. I will ask Mrs. Medrano, Kim Hall, when she was with us, who is the president of the Alumni Association, to give the 50th Anniversary Alumni Award, initiated by the class of 1928, to that sixth former who exhibits outstanding leadership ability. It is awarded this year to Rodrigo Tejado Gomez Sotomayor, Mexico City, Mexico. The McLeod Prize in memory of Dr. and Mrs. Colin McLeod, endowed by Mrs. McLeod and her daughter Mary Woodruff, to that member of the sixth form who, by high ideals, faithfulness to duty, earnest endeavor, and sound character, has made a contribution worthy of praise. It is awarded this year to Levon Paul Elliott G. Ross, Abidjan, Côte d'Ivoire. The Trustees Prize, given in recognition of the highest GPA in the upper school, maintained over a 2-year period, is awarded to Camilla Maria Power Edmonds Washington. The Moulton Profecit Prize, in memory of Dr. Lawrence Hoyer, endowed by his wife, Phyllis Hoyer, is awarded to that member of the sixth form who, with broad interests and with participation in a wide range of activities, has achieved in all a commendable success. It is awarded this year to Zachary Maxwell Zanetti, Hagerstown, Maryland. The Centennial Prize, in memory of Evelyn Richardson Onderdonk, to that member of the sixth form who has made an outstanding contribution to the immediate general welfare of the school along one or more lines, is awarded to Daniel Paul Peacher, Hagerstown, Maryland. The Headmaster's Prize, which is given by the faculty, is awarded to that member of the sixth form who best exemplifies the qualities of a scholar as evidenced by academic success, enthusiasm for learning, and positive engagement in class discussion. It is awarded this year to Yuching Lin Chen, Madrid, Spain. The Bishop's Prize, and if the bishop will come forward to give it, by tradition, the school's highest prize and greatest honor, is awarded to that member of the sixth form who has contributed most to the long-range, long-term welfare of the school, either by accomplishment or by personal example, in this case, both, is awarded to Sean James Rowe, Fairplay, Maryland. Now, Holly, and Bryce, and Peter, and TJ, and anybody I may be missing, oh, Trace in the back, if you'll take your sunglasses off, and if everybody will please come forward. No, please stand, and then you come forward later. I was distracted. The reason we do that, by the way, is so we get good photographs. Please refrain from applauding or making any other celebratory sound until all have received their diplomas. This isn't a beauty contest or a popularity contest. They graduate as a form. Do all the parents and assorted relatives understand that? And do you doubt my ability to shut it down? Ask them. By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees, you have been found qualified for suitable recognition through award of the school diploma or the promise of the school diploma. Well, actually, you're all getting a school diploma. Once the remaining, I take that out too, you're all getting a diploma. And if I could ask Mr. Salisbury, the Vice Chair, and Bishop Sutton, if you'll come forward, and I think the lineup is me, then you, Todd, and then you, Bishop. That's how that works. You'll be all right on the stairs?
Yep.
In this order, correct?
Yeah.
Josephine Edewede Ogar Uhigbe. Olivia Grace Azam. Felipe Avellaneda. Sarah Osama Baker. Holly Elizabeth Gaver Butcher. Jintian CJ Tsao. Povilas Chereshka. Catherine Rose Charlton. Levon Paul Elliott Giros. Chase Henry Dotson. Joshua Meldrabzik. Yuanxi Dexter Du. Temidayo Jason Eniola. Kali Wanal Ferguson. Andrew Murdoch French. Colin Alexander Green. Asa Panayotis Hammer. Osamede Beatrice Emariagbe. Ronnie Renee Ireland. Audrey Alexandra Johnson. Bryce Scott Kilmer. Sungbum Lee. Yuxing Lin Chen. Callie Jensen Mahoney. Walter Herman Maynard the Fifth. Molly Radford McPhillan. Dokyung Oh. Ayomide Alua Thomason Ajoa. Daniel Paul Peacher. Camilla Maria Power. Rachel Anjali Rao. Robert Benson Reiser. Sean James Rowe. Ryan Michael Scott. Thomas Anthony Starkowski III. Haoming Sun. Rodrigo Tejado Gomez Sotomayor. Paris Alexa Thiele. And in memoriam, Siddiqui Baki Thomas Suwali. Shrenik Tripathi. Huesi Jesse Wong. Jingchao Linda Wang. Chaltu Dwayne Watkins. Phyllis S. Wu. Lynn Estrella Tariam Yambaye. Eileen Peter Young. Zachary Yuen. Zachary Maxwell Zanetti. Emily Zhang. Sahan Annie Chow.
I present you the graduating class of St. James School, the year of our Lord, 2022. I know, Shani. Bless you. Good job, Quinn. You're welcome. And good job, parents and special friends. Well done. Welcome to St. James. And remember, you're not graduating. I always point that out. We now move on to the sixth form, as the former sixth form has now graduated. The Holloway Prize Scholarships endowed in honor of James L. Holloway III, class of 1939, and in memory of James L. Holloway IV, class of 1963, are given to up to two incoming members of the sixth form who have distinguished themselves as scholars, athletes, and examples for good within the St. James community. The prizes are awarded by vote of the faculty, and in order to be eligible, a student must be a varsity athlete in three sports, which is an achievement in itself, have achieved honors and high honors in the fifth form, and viewed by the faculty as generally positive and helpful in their relationships with other students. The $5,000 scholarships afforded by this endowment are applied towards boarding tuition in the sixth form, reflecting the Holloway's own experience as boarding students at St. James. One prize is awarded this year, which is often the case, and the prize scholarship is presented this year to Don Segwachet Nyanu, Laurel, Maryland. Dante, I will say that Admiral Holloway is smiling on this because he always, it's especially appropriate when it goes to a wrestler. The Fields Prize Scholarships endowed in memory of Ambassador Lewis G. Fields, Jr. are awarded to up to two incoming members of the sixth form who have distinguished themselves as scholars, persons of high character and courage, and examples of good within the St. James community. The prizes are awarded by vote of the faculty. In order to be eligible, a student must have achieved honors or high honors in the fifth form, participated in a well-rounded program of extracurricular activities, and be viewed by the faculty as generally positive and helpful in their relationships. The $5,000 scholarships afforded by this endowment are applied towards boarding tuition in the sixth form. And they are awarded this year to Xiao Tao Teresa Shang, Liaoning, China, and Andrew George Weisgerber, Frederick, Maryland. The Lee Prizes, endowed in honor of Robert E. Lee IV in recognition of his long service to St. James School as a trustee, are awarded by vote of the faculty this year to five incoming sixth formers whose earnest endeavor and polite manner make them a particular credit to the society of the school. The $5,000 scholarships afforded by this endowment are applied towards boarding tuition in the sixth form, and they are awarded this year to Ezra William Burdett, Brownsville, Maryland, Christopher Gambrell James, Hagerstown, Maryland, Kayla Y. Hanley, Silver Spring, Maryland, Robertson Jack Ashby Jacobs, Ontario, Canada, and Piyush Sethi, Odisha, India.
You called that one.
Thank you.
Oh, really? We fall apart about now.
The following have been appointed sacristans and have been invested for this office in the chapel: as senior sacristan, Don Senyachit Yanu; as senior marshal, Philip Lawrence Aguila; as senior thurifer, Elise Marie Bamforth; as senior chorister, Xiaotu Teresa Sheng, Isaac Jusen Shin; senior usher, Paige Spotsworth Bacon; senior reader, Theodore Macbeth Carter; as sacristans in the fifth, Mia Giselle, as sacristans, Mia Giselle Alvarez, Robertson Jack Ashby Jacobs, Hiao Hyun Nate Lim, Andrew Shu Sullivan, Olivia Claire Topham; as ushers, Ezra William. I think our delegate should get the Maryland flag to. As ushers, Ezra William Burdett, Jennifer Eileen Diaz, Christopher Gambrel James, and Minji Daniel Liu. Congratulations, and thank you for your service to come. Kim, if you'd come forward again, you have one more. Members of the sixth form met with me and Mrs. McGuigan, Mrs. Fry, and Dr. Regan to look ahead to their futures as alumni. The following two members of the graduating class have been appointed class agents, so if you'll come forward to be welcomed by Mrs. Medrano, Asa Hammer and Catherine Charlton. Congratulations. The Spence and Cinda Perry Faculty Prize, endowed by Spence Perry, former faculty member and trustee, and his wife Cinda, provides a grant for summer travel to a member of the St. James faculty who has distinguished himself or herself by faithful service to the school and exemplary devotion to his or her students. It is given this year to a teacher who has been with us for 22 years and has served the school in many capacities: coach, dorm head, director of college counseling, dean of students, academic dean, and assistant headmaster. This year, he has returned to full-time teaching and coaching and is chair of the English department. We acknowledge his many years of generous service to the school and the gift of his teaching to his colleagues and his students. Mark Batson. Summer study and continuing education grants have been issued to the following members of the faculty: Mary Catherine Berry, Master's in English, Middlebury College, Breadloaf School of English at Lincoln College, Oxford University in Oxford, England, the United Kingdom. John Brown, Gaming and Simulations for Learning. Sounds fun. Johns Hopkins, Maryland. Cody Pillow, Dean's Roundtable, Dedham, Massachusetts. Joseph Safo Kantanka, AP Statistics Workshop, Taft School in Connecticut, and Linda Morgan Stowe, Association of Anglican Musicians National Conference at Richmond, Virginia. Congratulations and thank you. It now falls upon me to announce the prefects for next year, and I always explain for the benefit of parents and those visiting, prefects are elected in two equal colleges, the faculty college and the student college, so you have to essentially win in both. And they are appointed by me, and because they are officers of the school, and they're given very significant responsibilities, which have been very well served this year, for which we are very grateful. And we look forward to more good work to come. Philip, and if your name is read, you'll come forward. Philip, you're already up, I know you. Philip Lawrence Aguila, if you come forward. Robertson Jack Ashby Jacobs. I don't think you heard me. Robertson Jack Ashby Jacobs. Paige Spotswood Bacon. Elise Marie Bamforth. Just go, Philip, you just go across, like that way. Then you go with it. There you go. Ezra William Burdett. Kayla Y. Hanley. Christopher Gambrell James. Chelsea Pepra. It definitely helps if you have girls cheering for you. I don't know. Shout out Teresa Shung. Kyle Stephen Simon Guerin. Danse Nakchet Yanu. Yes, Danse, I called your name. Like Jacob's Ladder, isn't it? And the senior prefect for the 2022-2023 session is Danse Nakchet Yanu. Prefect should meet with Mr. Hutchings immediately following the commencement service at the senior steps, and the six form sacristans should meet with Father Montgomery. And now it just falls upon me to invite all of you to lunch. They always make way too much food, and I hope you'll join us, and to declare that the academic session 2021-2022 is now officially closed. I call upon Bishop Sutton to give us his benediction.
Please stand. It is my great honor to bless this proceeding. St. James School is officially the Bishop's School, and the Bishop of Maryland is always very, very honored and proud of this school. To the graduates, may God bless you with the grace to never sell yourself short. May God bless you with the courage to risk something big for something good. And may God bless you with the wisdom that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. We did.
Yes, we made it. These are fun. Yes.